We were dropped off at an airstrip in the middle of nowhere I'd ever been. Holy cow, this was the Masai Mara. We collected and loaded, first our bags and then ourselves, into the special order Toyota Land Rovers that were waiting for us. For the next 2 weeks, in both Kenya and Tanzania, we would spend a goodly amount of time each day in these bush limousines, as they are called. Roaming the Serengeti in the pursuit of game viewing, we never knew what would cross our path. Every day was a new adventure, and every day the result exceeded our expectations. As the map shows, the Serengeti ecosystem is divided between the two countries of Tanzania and Kenya, and we therefore had different driver guides during the Kenyan and Tanzanian portions of the tour. In Kenya and the Masai Mara, our chief guide was George, a proud Maasai, shown here in both everyday appearance and warrior dress-up. Always with a smile on his face, George unerringly led us to our game viewing destination. In Tanzania, our chief guide was Lube, a true Renaissance man and fount of knowledge, both scientific and cultural, who helped us manage our journey. Whether at a fireside lecture at our tented home base on the Serengeti Plain, or en route on one of the bush limos, or on arrival at our destination du jour, Lube provided a constant stream of information, knowledge, and wisdom in the right doses at the right time. Both in Kenya and Tanzania, we were blessed to have exceptional driver guides. In Kenya, our driver guides were Oscar, Daoud, and Hassan Jahad. In Tanzania, our driver guides were Asus and Everest. All were highly skilled in navigating the bumpy roads with minimal discomfort to our posteriors. Also, whether it was stopping to retrieve a dropped iPhone or changing a tire in record time, they were always ready to adjust to the needs of the moment. Each of them was also a guide in the true sense. Their keen spotting of game continually astounded us, and as they also excelled in explaining the behaviors of the game we were seeing, we were doubly appreciative of their skills. The Serengeti National Park of Tanzania encompasses an enormously large area of 14,000 square kilometers, or 5,700 square miles. The park is named most appropriately, for in the Maasai language, Serengeti means endless plains. Surrounding the park are the Ngorongoro Conservation Area, the Maswa Game Reserve, the Grumeti Game Reserve, and the Masai Mara Game Reserve, and the Loliondo Controlled Area. Together with the park, these areas constitute the Greater Serengeti Ecosystem, which is about double the size of the park itself, totaling some 30,000 square kilometers or 12,000 square miles, about the size of Northern Ireland. Ungulates as a category means having hoofs, or should I say hooves. On the Serengeti, that includes elephants, rhinoceroses, warthogs, buffalo, giraffe, and zebras, as well as wildebeests and the many other varieties of antelope. All these ungulates and many more call the Serengeti Plains home, millions of them, in fact. And because of that, the Serengeti ecosystem really should be called Kingdom of the Ungulates. We soon came to understand why, in this Kingdom of the Ungulates, the zebra-wildebeest partnership has a special place of prominence. Together, they are the driving force behind the great cyclic migration on the Serengeti. Close to 3 million individuals participate each year in this grueling event of over 1,000 miles, but only the wildebeest and zebras complete the entire journey. The wildebeest-zebra partnership reigns supreme in the kingdom of the ungulates because of their ability to follow the reins. By following the reins as they advance southward and retreat northwards, the wildebeest-zebra partnership secures the green grasses and grains necessary to feed their millions. Deeply attuned to the annual weather and life cycle of the Serengeti Plains, the zebra and wildebeest partnership evolved the division of labor on several levels. Nutritionally, while the wildebeest prefers to munch on the soft, short grasses, the zebra happily crunches on the hardier, long-stalked grasses for his calories. The zebra also is not beyond using his greater mental abilities to his own benefit and to the detriment of his wildebeest partners. At the perilous river crossings, our guides told us, the zebras are often observed to hang back and wait to allow the wildebeest to cross first. Then, when all the crocodiles are busy devouring wildebeest, the zebras will cross with minimum of casualties. The typical events that marks the annual Serengeti climate and migration cycle unfolds like this. The wet season starts in November, when northern winds bring the rains and increasingly push them further south. With the animals following the rain, the wildebeest zebra herds also begin to move south on the eastern side of the Serengeti Plain. Their destination are their calving grounds of the central and southern Serengeti Plains, where they will bear their young in January and February. Beginning in March and April, the process reverses and the winds and rains begin to retreat northward again. As a result, the animals begin moving around restlessly on the southern Serengeti Plains. And in May, their movements coalesce into a generally northward direction on the western side of the Serengeti Plain. With the start of the dry season in June, the herds proceed moving north in long columns of hundreds to thousands of animals. In July and August, the migration crosses not only the Grumeti River, but also the Mara River further north. The months of September and October, the herds spend in the Masai Mara game reserve, where, even in the absence of rain, water remains continuously available. In November, the cycle starts again with the beginning of renewed movement south of both rain and the herds in the next wet season. A note of concern here. In our own experience, while traveling in September, we experienced heavy rains that were months premature for the time of year. In other words, climate change and global warming are making the weather and migration timetables more erratic and less predictable. This will pose an increasingly serious threat to the continued existence of the migration cycle and the health of the herds that make them happen. Of the 3 million participants in the Serengeti migration, 1 million or so do not complete the entire loop. Except for the wildebeests, who do complete the entire journey, this group of partial migrators includes the many other members of the numerous antelope family, such as a Grant's gazelle, Thompson's gazelle, impala, Koch's hartebeest, topi, waterbuck, and others. Let's just sit back a few minutes and watch them. Not all ungulates participate in the migration. Some only go along part way, like the Cape buffalo and the antelopes, while others are more strictly territorial. These are the elephants, giraffes, hippos, and warthogs, and also the primates, such as the vervet monkeys and baboons. Thank you. The presence of so many ungulate species on the Serengeti provides the perfect conditions for a thriving predator-prey relationships between the herds and the top predators, the crocodiles and the big cats. On our trip, we did not have much opportunity to see the crocodiles in action. We did see one giant specimen peacefully sleeping next to two hippos, a scene our guides described as unbelievable and surreal. But we did witness and record the drama and excitement of the great cats at work, especially the lions, but also the leopards and cheetahs, as well as various scavengers. Of all the big cats, only the lions are powerful and plenty enough to engage in the teamwork necessary to hunt the larger sized ungulates such as zebra, wildebeest, and Cape buffalo on a regular basis. And indeed, it has proven to be a mutually beneficial arrangement. In Tanzania alone, the zebra and wildebeest herds each number in the millions and provide enough prey to support thousands of lions that help maintain the health of the herds by removing its old, sick, and weakened members. This leaves the smaller cats, such as the cheetahs and leopards, who are far fewer in number and tend to be more solitary hunters, to hunt the smaller prey, such as the various types of gazelles, impalas, etc. We also witnessed how the scavenger species are part and parcel of nature's way on the Serengeti. Feeding on death as well as life, they serve the important natural function of completing the Serengeti's life recycling system. The scavengers include several mammalian species such as hyenas, jackals, and wild dogs, but also, importantly, several species of birds such as the lappet-faced vulture and marabou storks. among the hooves of the grazing millions of ungulates, billions of smaller grazers are also at work, as grasshoppers, termites, caterpillars, beetles, and rodents probably eat more grass than all the ungulates combined. In turn, these billions of small and smaller critters feed an amazing array of birds, many of which migrate great distances each year from Europe, Asia, and other countries in Africa. Fully a quarter of 530 species of birds recorded in the Serengeti are migratory, temporary residents in the park, come to feed off its riches before heading home again in March and April. In their variety of riotous colors and patterns, the African birds are a universe to themselves and totally absorbing. Putting it all together, the context of all this animal motion and color, we were moved deeply by the Serengeti landscape. Or should I say, that infinity of Serengeti landscapes that embraces all opposites, that is both vast and diverse, captivating and liberating, severe and serene, quieting and disquieting, exhilarating and awe-inspiring. Thank you. When we arrived, pretty early in the morning, the village seemed quiet, almost deserted. But quickly people started appearing, especially the kids, curious as kids will be. When villagers and visitors all gathered together, the chiefs and the little chief addressed us and bade us welcome. That done, we followed them to the corral to admire the cattle and watch a demonstration of fire making by the young tribesmen. Then all the men gathered together and paraded through the village, complete with dancing in which the women also joined. Next, the women demonstrated and taught their specialized areas of expertise. First, we went inside the midwife's place for a presentation and discussion of family organization and practices. Afterwards, outside again, the women demonstrated and taught the traditional method of corn mashing, tribal dressing, and the making of beading and jewelry. One day, Lube took us to a Maasai market in Tanzania. The market speaks for itself, the vibrancy of the colors, so expressive of the people's natural joy and community spirit. The economy of the Maasai and other pastoral tribes is centered around cattle. Cattle are the measure of wealth and the medium of exchange in marriage and other social interactions. Water always being a very scarce resource, humans and their cattle often drink water from the same sources. And herein lies a big health problem. For when humans drink the same water as their own and other animals, that water is 100% guaranteed contaminated by the feces and urine of those animals. In other words, that water is loaded with untold microorganisms, such as bacteria and parasites, that can cause widespread disease and even death to the humans drinking it. Consider these statistics. Worldwide, contaminated water causes over 4 billion cases of diarrhea each year, resulting in 2.2 million deaths annually, 86% of which occur among children under the age of 5 years old. On the African continent, 40% of Africans, over 330 million people, do not have access to safe drinking water. In Tanzania alone, 44 million people do not have access to clean water and are forced to drink contaminated water. What you are seeing in these photographs is the manufacture of a remarkable ceramic water filter that filters out 99.99% of dirt, bacteria, parasites, and microorganisms that are in water. It has a lifespan of about 5 years. This picture shows the amazing difference between the water before and after filter treatment. The filters are manufactured by Safe Water Ceramics of East Africa in their factory in Arusha. Lube, our guide, had taken us there on an educational expedition to remedy our lack of awareness about the water problem. The tour began with a general introduction to the process of producing the filters. Then the composition of the clay and the shaping process was explained. also the very exacting drying and firing procedures in the kiln. Laura and Dan volunteer to apprentice hands-on with the master to produce an actual filter, and completed the project big time happy. Our group was so excited after the visit that there was much talk about doing something. In the end, what we did under the guidance of Lube was to pool our resources and buy 15 of the ceramic water filters. Lube assured us that these filters were sure to find a fitting home tomorrow during the day's game viewing excursion. The next morning, as we were driving along, we chanced upon a large watering hole where many shepherds were watering their flocks of goats, donkeys, cows, etc. Lube told the drivers to pull over, and we piled out, highly anticipative of what was about to happen. At first, there was some blowback expressed by some of the elder members of the groups that were watering their animals there. But when Lube explained the purpose of our visit and explained the use and care of the ceramic filters, the mood changed for the better to one of excitement and appreciation. It was a happy moment. For the shepherds, a miracle had occurred. For the tourists, a sense of satisfaction at having made, however small, a concrete contribution to alleviate some human misery. Another day, Lube announced that this was the day he was going to take us out of our comfort zone and test us to see how we would manage in an unexpected situation. To accomplish his goal, he took us to the small village of Karatu, where he divided our group into four smaller teams. Then he gave each of these teams a list of a half dozen or so food items. Our mission was to roam the market, engage people, find the items, and purchase them with local money. In one way, the exercise was very successful, because all teams were able to quickly purchase the items on their list. But in another way, it was a complete failure, in that none of us suffered from being out of our comfort zone. All the villagers were so helpful that it was simply too fun to experience much discomfort. One day, we made another spontaneous stop at a very colorful local roadside stand where a family of mat weavers displayed and sold their beautiful wares. The matriarch and chief weaver was very hospitable, graciously explaining and demonstrating the finer points of the grass weaving art. Barbara took the weavers up on their invitation to give it a whirl and sat down to try her hand at it. Then the discussion moved on the subject of colors, and a demonstration was given on the art of dyeing of the materials. From the many kids and grandkids jokingly playing around in back, it was obvious this business was supporting a large extended family. Yet another day, Lube took us out to visit Iraku village, home of a tribe by the same name. The Iraku are part of the larger Kush ethnicity and speak one of the linguistically very rare glottal clicking languages. When we arrived, a large, jovial man came out to greet us and introduced himself as Baba Dingo, assistant tribal chief and village elder. After introductions, Chief Baba Dingo took us on a tour of the brick factory that his tribe operates in and for the community. He describes the processes of mixing the clay, shaping the bricks, drying them, stacking them, and firing them, all obviously arduous and backbreaking work. Chief Papadingo explained that the brick factory functions as a kind of bootstrap operation, where a person can go into the business for himself, making and selling bricks. From the brick factory, Chief Papadingo then led us on a short walk to his house, welcomed us into his home, and introduced us to the various members of his family. Chief Papadingo turned out to be a talented musician and played a mean tune on the zeze, a violin-like traditional string instrument. With his son and other family musicians, they struck up some catchy rhythms, and soon all of us were up on our feet, dancing and stomping up a storm. Finally, tribal costumes were produced and handed out to everyone, and it was showtime. The dress-up was fun, and everyone had to pose for everyone at great length and with great hilarity. I would like to conclude this photo essay on our visit to East Africa with a few images of our group's interaction with students from the Rotia Primary School in the Ngorongoro Highlands. The school is one of many worldwide that is sponsored by Overseas Adventure Travel's parent organization, the Grand Circle Foundation. We came bearing a number of educational gifts for the students and were treated warmly in return with enthusiastic dancing and singing exhibitions. It is evident from the images that despite linguistic limitations, excellent student-visitor interactions occurred.